Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and this is the first in the dissection supplementary videos, or supplementary dissection videos, we'll call them either one. And in these videos, we're going to walk through the structures on the list of structures and talk about how we're going to be able to identify them. We're not usually going to get too much into why we're having you identify them or some of the basics in terms of innervation, etc. These videos are more for how do I identify this structure? What's the pertinent anatomical relationships that I need to know in order to be able to identify them? So we're going to start with osteology for your anterior neck and thorax session. And we are starting with the humerus. The humerus is going to be the unpaired bone of your arm, okay? So of your arm, not of your forearm. And you can see that is going to articulate up here with the scapula. We'll see some of the more distal articulations with the bones of the forearm later. And really, we're focused more on this proximal region of the humerus in this session because you do have the pectoralis major that will have an attachment over here in this proximal portion of the bone. So this is going to be the more proximal portion. This will be the more distal portion. Now, articulating with the humerus will be a bone of the pectoral girdle, and the pectoral girdle is going to include two different bones. It will include the clavicle and the scapula, and you can see the scapula has numerous projections here as well. So this is an anterior view right here. This is a posterior view, so you can see quite a bit more of the scapula. That's why we call this the shoulder blade colloquially. And here is the clavicle right here, which is more anteriorly placed. They are going to articulate together right in this region at the acromioclavicular joint. There is one projection that we want you to be able to identify in this session of the scapula, and this is called the coracoid process. And this is going to be anteriorly projecting. And the reason we're having you identify this particular structure for this session is that that pectoralis minor is going to have a distal attachment on the coracoid process. The hyoid bone, so of course we talked infrahyoid muscles in this session, so the hyoid bone, all those muscles are going to be inferior to the hyoid bone. And this hyoid bone, you can see it right in this region right here. And it is what's referred to as a free floating bone. It looks like it's sitting kind of right on top of the vertebral column, but importantly, it's not part of the vertebral column. And you can see it looks kind of like this wing-shaped bone right here. It does not directly articulate with any other bone. It is going to have some ligaments attached to it, certainly some muscles, and it's going to be associated with the anterior neck region. Moving to the sternum is often colloquially referred to as the breastbone, and you can palpate your sternum. So if you kind of put your finger right at the top of your sternum, you'd be feeling this region right here called the suprasternal notch. It's that divot that's palpable. And the suprasternal notch is part of the manubrium, or the handle of the sternum. And really the sternum is divided into three different parts, the manubrium, as we have here, the body, which we're not going to identify quite yet, and then the xiphoid process, which is going to be the inferior most portion and by far the most variable portion of the sternum. No xiphoid process looks alike between individuals. And if you kind of put it into context, here are the clavicles, which do articulate with this top portion of the manubrium. And you can see that body and the xiphoid here. And so importantly, you're going to have a lot of rib articulations going on as well as clavicular articulations. Moving to portions of the skull or the cranial base, the difference between the skull and cranium. Skull will include the mandible or that lower jaw, whereas the crania or cranium will not. And so a lot of times you'll hear us refer to as certain either the cranium or the skull. Here, we do not have that mandible here, so we're talking about the cranial base. And this is basically the bottom portion where the brain will sit. So I'm looking at a superior view right now of the cranial base. I had to remove the skull cap or the calvaria in order to look in here. So during life, the brain would be sitting right in this region. And you can see this really irregularly shaped foramen right here. That is going to allow for the passage of the IJV, or the internal jugular vein, so a very important vein of the neck. So all that blood, deoxygenated or mostly deoxygenated blood from the brain, is going to travel through the internal jugular vein on its way back to the heart. You can also see this from an inferior view of the cranial base. So we kind of tipped a cranium upside down, and you can see it right in this region here. In this particular one, you can see that there's a little bit of a bone that kind of moved right here. There will also be some cranial nerves that are going to exit through the jugular foramen. And one particular note is going to be cranial nerve 11, which is the accessory nerve. The accessory nerve actually is going to ascend through the foramen magnum and then exit again through the jugular foramen in order to get out and head towards the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius muscle. So cranial nerve 11, as well as cranial nerves 9 and 10. Let's, for today's session, that's kind of one of the major focuses. And last but not least, we have the mastoid process. The mastoid process is going to be a part of this temporal bone, which you can see right here. It's a pretty complex bone. You have lots of fun processes extending in this region. We'll talk about it when we're looking at within the cranial base in other sessions. But really what we're focusing on is this projection, this inferior projection of the temporal bone called the mastoid process. So if you put your fingers underneath your ear, you are palpating this part of the bone, and this is your mastoid process. And importantly, that sternocleidomastoid muscle will have one of its superior attachments to the mastoid process. All right, so that is the osteology that you need to be able to identify in today's session. We will have videos, similar videos, for the muscles, the veins, the arteries, and the nerves that you need to be able to identify. As you work through these, try to figure out how you're going to identify them, and hopefully you can use these videos to help, and of course, if you are dissecting as well. But then think about why we wanted you to be able to identify these. So what is going to attach there, like in the case of the mastoid process, or what is going to travel there, as in the case of the jugular foramen. Thank you for your time and attention here, and as always, please reach out if you have any questions. Have a great day.